Jim Jordan is on the House Freedom Caucus. How are you, sir? Welcome aboard. I would like to know, number one, how is it possible that James Comey still doesn't know that about the contents, the veracity of the contents of this dossier that Clinton bought and paid for, that a foreign national put together using Russian sources? He still doesn't know it's true, but as we've learned from the Grassley-Graham memo and the Nunes memo, well, the bulk of information to obtain that warrant to spy on a Trump campaign associate came from a dossier that he never verified.
Yeah, and he testified under oath that it was unverified. And they took it to the FISA court and didn't tell the court two important things. One, who paid for it, which is a kind of important fact. And second, they didn't tell the court that the author of that dossier, Christopher Steele, his relationship with the FBI had been terminated because he broke a cardinal rule. He went and told the press he was working for the FBI. So in the three subsequent renewals that they got on that FISA application that they took to the court, they didn't tell the court the whole truth like you and I would have to if we're in front of a court of law.
Well, it's even worse than that, isn't it? I mean, they didn't tell the whole truth. They never verified. Isn't by FISA law, don't you have an obligation to present only verified, corroborated things to the judge? If he's saying, well, I don't know if it's true, anything could be true, that is hardly the type of information you present to a court to get a warrant to spy on an American, and then not telling the judge that, in fact, the opposition party candidate paid for this through a foreign national, you know, using Russian sources. That seems to me like they were lied to on a spectacular level.
Yeah, this would be humorous if it wasn't so serious, because maybe the first thing that should tell you that this might not be real good fact, might not be fact at all, is who paid for it, right? Maybe that's the first thing you should check and say, maybe we should be a little suspect and really double check everything before we take it. They didn't do that, even though they knew it was an Oppo research document. In fact, what they did, in my judgment, is they dressed it all up, made it look like it was legitimate intelligence, took it to the court, and got the warrant to spy on someone associated with President Trump's campaign, which is as wrong as it gets. Again, you or I can't go into a court of law. When we go into a court of law, we're supposed to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. It sure looks like they did not do that with this dossier.
Well, the other part, and now I guess we have to wait till May for the Inspector General's report as it relates to the investigation into the Hillary Clinton email server. Look, I'm not a lawyer, but when I read 18 U.S.C. 793, I think it's pretty obvious you can't mishandle or destroy classified top secret special access programming information, which she did. And then if a committee you're on, you subpoena documents for me and I start deleting them and acid washing my hard drive and beating up or having somebody bust up my BlackBerries to destroy them, is that the definition of obstruction of justice?
Yes. Yes. And never forget, Sean, I asked Secretary Clinton this under oath in front of the Benghazi committee. I said, Secretary, why don't you agree to let a neutral third party, like a retired federal judge, have access to all 60,000 of your emails and let that individual decide which ones are personal that you get to keep and which ones belong to our committee, belong back to the government for the American people to see. She would not agree to that. Now, think about this. President Trump would take that deal in a heartbeat based on what happened last week, where they just go in and grab everything Michael Cohen has, grab it all. He'd love to have a neutral third party like a retired federal judge on the front end, but no, Clinton wouldn't do that, and it got even worse. What they did is they said to Cheryl Mills, her lawyer, hey, Cheryl, when do you want us to come over? You've already looked through everything. When can we come over and pick up the ones that we're entitled to get? You tell us what's a good time for you. That's how they treated her compared to what we saw last week. That is the part that more than anything frustrates the American people.
Why is it taking so long, do you think, for us to get information on all of these matters? And let me just give you a short list of all of this. You have the surveillance, the unmasking, the leaking of raw intelligence, unmasking at a rate we've never seen before. Samantha Powers, almost one a day for the last year she's in office. Why would a UN ambassador be unmasking anybody? And then leaking raw intelligence, that's also a crime. That happened, we know, in the case of Michael Flynn. But then you have the way this investigation into Hillary's email was handled. Now, if we know she committed felonies, and we know that Comey and Trump hater Peter Strzok were writing the exoneration, and then Strzok got assigned to interviewing Hillary Clinton, we have to know that the fix was in here. Is there any doubt in your mind that that investigation was rigged? Because I have no doubt.
Well, we thought the fix was in before the struck page text messages. Now that we've got the struck page text messages, we know the fix was in. So you're exactly right. And here's the thing about James Comey. I think that most of the American people feel like this guy has zero credibility. He screwed up the investigation into Secretary Clinton from the get-go. I criticized him in July when he did the big press conference and came out and as the FBI director said that they weren't going to prosecute and laid it all out. And I criticized him again in October when he announced he was reopening. I took heat from Republicans. But my position was, and I think the vast majority of Americans' position is, this guy screwed it up from the get-go. Of course the fix was in. Anyone who's objective can see that now.
Yeah, well, anybody. So where does this go from here? And do we have to now worry about statute of limitations running out?
Here's where it goes. We got to get the documents, and we met with John Lyles, Congressman Meadows, and I met with a new point person at DOJ on getting his documents, and I asked him four questions last week. I said, tell us the approximate universe of documents we're entitled to. Tell us the standard you currently use to determine what gets redacted. Tell us the number of steps in your current process. And then, of course, the most important question, tell us when we're going to, as a separate and equal branch of government, get what we're entitled to. And their answers last week were, I don't know, I don't know, I don't know, I don't know. Now, since then, they sent us a letter yesterday, and their answers are approximately 46,000 documents that we're entitled to that they think is the universe we should get. And then the other three questions are still, I don't know. So not a big improvement in 1 week's time. That is the big problem. And their answer is, well, this is the way it's always been done. Well, that's the problem. You've got to change things, people.
All right, we got to take a break. We'll come back more with Jim Jordan of the Freedom Caucus, Ohio congressman on the other side. All right, as we continue with Ohio Congressman, Freedom Caucus member Jim Jordan is with us. What do we have any idea what Comey was referring to when he threw Loretta Lynch under the bus with information that nobody at this point knows about that caused him to feel that he needed to usurp her power and step in and be the public face of the Clinton email investigation? Because whatever it is, it sounds ominous.
Yeah, it does. I do not know. I do not know if it's something that was communicated in the now infamous tarmac meeting. I do not know. I think that in and of itself is a big concern that, you know, Loretta Lynch met with former President Clinton 3 days before Secretary Clinton was to be interviewed. But I don't know if it was something conveyed in that conversation that he knows about that we don't. I just do not know. But even apart from that, it still was wrong for Mr. Comey to take this over. And obviously the actions of Loretta Lynch were wrong as well.
What about one other thing? When Comey said, oh, my God, did we have some role in this when Donald Trump won?
Come on. The only reason Comey even brought it forward is because, and we all thought this, I mean, we've said this before, is because he thought she was going to win. Everyone in the swamp here thought she was going to win. So he's like, oh, there's no harm here. I'll do this. And bringing it from other than that, if he didn't think she was going to win, I don't think he'd announce that they'd reopened the investigation. But these guys, think about this, Sean. James Comey's been fired. Andrew McCabe's been fired. Jim Baker, former FBI chief counsel, has been demoted, reassigned. Peter Strzok, deputy head of counterintelligence, demoted, reassigned. Lisa Page, FBI counsel, demoted, reassigned. These are the top people of the FBI. When have you ever seen that many people fired, demoted, reassigned, who were running the place? Of course, there were big problems.
And what about Comey now? His mandate was Trump-Russia collusion and anything associated. Now we're talking about Stormy Daniels, Karen McDougal, the Access Hollywood tape, and he seems to be latching on to just about anything that would work for him.
Here's something that is relatively recent that concerns me, is Rod Rosenstein wrote this additional memo on August 2nd. You know, May 17th of last year, the special counsel's name, Rod Rosenstein, writes a memo outlining the parameters of the special counsel's investigation. He does a supplement to that on August 2nd. It became public just a few weeks ago, and the vast majority of that document is redacted. I want to know why. I want to know what in that document, what changed? Was this a change in the parameters of the special counsel investigation? Was this an amendment to it? Was this what was that document all about? And why did he have to put it in writing? Why couldn't he's the guy who Mueller has to answer to? He can just communicate to that.
What do you make of the fact that his approval rating is down now 11 points? He's at 32%, Robert Mueller. Are the American people getting hip to the fact that he appointed really people that have abused power in the past, like his pit bull, Andrew Weissman? Are you concerned about the people that he hired?
I think everyone is. And I think when you boil it all down, it's the American people don't like two standards. They don't like one set of rules for Sean Hannity, Jim Jordan, and regular folk across this country. in a different set if your name is Clinton, Comey, Lynch, Lerner. They don't like that. And they believe that this great nation, it's supposed to be equal treatment under the law. So that's why his numbers are going down. Because Americans are fundamentally concerned with equal treatment under the law.
Yeah, well, I guess if Sean Hannity or Jim Jordan spit on the sidewalk, we're going to get, not only a fine, we'll get handcuffed and mugshotted and perp walked.
Sean, Mike Flynn makes one false statement while not under oath, and he gets indicted. Andrew McCabe lies to James Comey, lies to the Office of Professional Responsibility, and then lies twice under oath to the Inspector General. And what happens to him? Nothing like what happened to Mike Flynn. That's what Americans hate.
Do you think there's a chance, based on the attorney involved, I'm sorry, the judge involved in the Flynn case is interesting to me because he also presided over the Ted Stevens case. And in that case, it was discovered that exculpatory evidence was withheld. By the way, Andrew Weissman has a history of being excoriated by judges for such. And the judge in the Flynn case said, I'll decide what's exculpatory and what's not. Do you think now that's an indication that this has a chance of being thrown out, his guilty plea agreement?
Yeah, I don't know. You have to talk to legal minds. I do know that the judge didn't recuse himself in the Flynn case till after the case is the same judge that Letha Page and Peter Strzok were talking about in some of their text message correspondence. And Peter Strzok was a friend of that judge, which seems strange. And I also know that that conversation was one of the documents that we got from the Department of Justice, and it was all redacted. We had to go to the Department of Justice to figure out that Judge Contreras and Peter Strzok were friends, and that Peter Strzok and Letha Page were talking about that friendship and how that may impact accusal going forward. All interesting stuff. Why it was redacted, why DOJ didn't want us to know that important piece of information, I'm not sure.
All right. Thank you so much, Jim Jordan. We appreciate you being with us. 800-941-SEAN if you want to be a part of the program.